Sorry for the delay, but I hope today's lecture will make up for this. It's our first event this semester, so it's thrilling to see you. If this is the our website where you can sign up for our future events, which we will have many this semester and next in the spring, to receive announcements, please sign up if you haven't been signed up yet. So our today's guest is someone who needs no introduction, of course, but it is Thomas Jensler, for just those who don't know. He is the foremost Lithuanian poet who writes poetry only in Lithuanian, but who has two other languages just nearly as native as his native Lithuanian, Polish and Russian. Until last year, he lived in the US since 77. When he emigrated from the former Soviet Union as a former Soviet dissident and founding member of the Lithuanian Helsinki Group. And after a successful career in the US as professor at Yale and other universities, last year he went back to Lithuania and he has just arrived from that part of the world. The event is also co-hosted today by Hunter's Center for Jewish Studies, and very importantly by the Lithuanian Consulate General in New York. It is a great pleasure to have this event co-hosted with the Lithuanian Consulate, and that's again not the first event we partner with the Consulate with. We had a film screening, and just last fall we had a talk by Uta Vanagaitė, the author of a famous and, should I say, scandalous book Musishke OB, which has a prehistory that dates back to Thomas Jensler's essay from 75, Lithuanians and Jews, which was the first text written by a Lithuanian on the topic from 1975. So without further ado, let me introduce Gražina from the Lithuanian Consulate, who will say a few words. And then we will proceed to the lecture itself. Thank you for coming.
Hello, my name is Gražina, surname Michnevičiūtė, and I'm Lithuanian Culture Attaché at the Consulate General in New York. But I'm also working as a Culture Attaché for United States, so sometimes traveling around United States. And it's a pleasure for us to introduce this first event, which is a part of the Litvak Days 2019 in New York. So we are starting the events that will be followed for the next year in 2020 with more interesting events and lectures and films and I think maybe some exhibitions. And we are very, very thankful for Hunter College that they are having the first event here. And tomorrow at Ivo Institute, if you will have a chance, you are welcome to come to a panel discussion where Thomas Jensler will be there. Then it will be co-hosted with the Ivo Institute for Jewish Research and Studies. And I'm very thankful for Jascha Klotz, who was one of the students of Thomas Jensler, as far as I know. And we hope it will be very interesting for you to listen to Thomas Jensler. So I'm just giving the floor to a professor. Thank you for coming and supporting us also. Thank you.
Thank you. Just a very quick alert, if you'd like. We also have a film crew in the audience who will be filming Professor Jensler as he speaks. And I hope you don't mind if the camera just goes around the audience just for a quick shot. Hope it's fine. Thank you.
Yeah. Okay, ladies and gentlemen, first of all, please excuse my English. It's shaky, my pronunciation is bad, my grammar is even worse, and that is notwithstanding the fact that I lived in the United States for 40 years. But I entered the country in the relatively mature age of 39, and that was simply too late to learn the language well. My Russian is as good as my Lithuanian, and my Polish is as good as my Lithuanian, but not my English. So, what I'm going to do today, I would like to present you a talk which I prepared 4 years ago and presented it in Vilnius, in Lithuanian language. Now I will present it with some additions and some updates in English translation. So, 44 years ago, I wrote an article or an essay with the title Jews and Lithuanians, which first appeared in the Jewish underground press in the Soviet Union, later in Israel. Still later, it was translated and published by Lithuanian emigres here in the United States. And it caused quite a stir in the emigre communities. Several persons belonging to the ethnic Lithuanian elite in the United States, not only in the United States, also in France. One of them was a famous scholar and semiotician, Algirdas Julius Greimas, or Algirdas Julian Greimas. So they told me that they agreed with what I wrote, and they were ready to put their signatures after my text, under my text. But there were responses from the opposite side as well, although they were mostly anonymous or pseudonymous. I was still in Lithuania at that time, and I left 2 years later. And there wasn't still is a person called Felix Dektor or Felixas Dektoras. Maybe the name is not totally alien to some of the present in the audience. He was a translator from Lithuanian to Russian, then an editor in the Jewish underground press. He asked me to write this essay about Jewish question in Lithuania, especially during the first years of the World War II. He was publishing reminiscences of the Kaunas ghetto and wanted an ethnic Lithuanian to say something on that topic, but obviously not a Soviet Lithuanian, and at that time I was, thank God, an anti-Soviet Lithuanian already. The text I wrote was dedicated to my daughter, whose name is Maria, and I call her Marita. She was 2 years old then. She's Jewish on her mother's side, incidentally, her mother is also Jewish only on her mother's side. So on my side, Marita is Lithuanian, as I am, and Christian, by the way. She was baptized. Although now she is rather than, yes, an agnostic. So I thought that when she grew up, it might be important to her to understand what happened between her two peoples. So what has changed during those 44 years which passed from the moment of the publication of that essay? Let's begin with Marita. She lives in Florida. She is now 46, a mother herself, and she considers herself an American and a Lithuanian. She has visited Lithuania several times, and now she has both citizenships, just like myself, an American citizenship and a Lithuanian citizenship. She was born in Vilnius. She has never been to Israel, but she knows a fair deal about the Holocaust, as many Americans know. By the way, I never asked her what my article meant for her. And we never discussed it at all. Felix Dektor, or Felixas Dektoras, is still alive and well. He divides his time between Israel and Moscow. And he is a book publisher. Most recently, he published writings of Zev Jabotinsky. So his views are at least as radical as the views of Jabotinsky. So, if we go to the heart of the matter in the essay, what really stands out is that Lithuanians then, including me, 44 years ago, knew practically nothing about Jewish history in Lithuania. The history textbooks of independent Lithuania between the two world wars dedicated at most a half page to Jews. The authors were only concerned with ethnic Lithuanians, also with Poles, but Poles were, according to the official view, either Lithuanians who had lost their ethnic identity, or treacherous enemies, or both. So, the Soviet textbooks did not mention Jews at all. The word itself seemed profane somehow, and it was avoided. There was writing about the mass murders during the war, but suppressing or attempting to suppress the fact that victims were mainly, although not exclusively Jews, but mainly, but definitely mainly Jews. On the other hand, ethnic Lithuanians, who were for the most part strictly anti-Soviet, interpreted Soviet propaganda contrarily. If the regime, and especially the KGB, said something, the truth was the diametrically exact opposite of that. If bourgeois nationalists were being denounced and accused, then that meant for an ethnic Lithuanian, anti-Soviet Lithuanian, that all of them, down to each and every individual, were heroes and freedom fighters. It was only the very rare person who understood that this made you dependent upon the KGB. The KGB was determining your concept of history, if only in a very perverse manner. So if they catch somebody, this or that somebody must be a hero. So, well, now I will make a short addition. I will probably tell you the things you, yes, many of you, if not everybody, already know, but I still will repeat it. So, before the war, the World War II, the Jews in Lithuania constituted about 8% of the population. In the capital city of Vilnius, half of the population was Jewish, half of the population. The another half was Polish. Ethnic Lithuanians made 2% of Vilnius population at that time. Now they make around 70%, I believe. That has changed very, very definitely. As a rule, Jewish people were the predominant ethnic group in little towns, in shtetls, because the Lithuanians, for the most part, were peasants. This situation was not very usual for the rest of Europe. And it could as well be regarded as a proof that the Jews felt more comfortable in Lithuania than in many other places. So, they were related, so to speak. They did not mix, as a rule. There were virtually no mixed marriages and so on. Only at the very end it started to happen. But they were connected because a Lithuanian peasant could not live without a Jewish merchant and vice versa. And during the Nazi occupation, more of Jews perished in Lithuania than anywhere else in Europe, about 94%. An entire world has ceased to exist and has been largely forgotten. Well, incidentally, in Lithuania, the Poles and the Germans also disappeared. They were forcibly evicted by Stalin, but they were not, for the most part, deprived of their lives. The Jewish world did not simply go underwater. Somebody submerged tens and hundreds of thousands of human beings along with it. Having, I would say, having detonated an enormous dam to achieve that purpose. So in recent years, as many of you probably have heard, the history of the Polish town Jedwabne has caused great repercussions. So, unfortunately, alas, in Lithuania, such Jedwabnes could be counted by the dozens and even by the hundreds. So, and a Lithuanian, an ethnic Lithuanian, and a Christian Lithuanian, I am both, must be able to talk about this with absolute honesty. It is not easy for me, for I love my people, and now that it deserves respect. Lithuania's historical destiny is very complex, but it has every Lithuanians have every reason to be proud of many of their traditions. In the Middle Ages, the Lithuanians founded a state that became, during the Renaissance, one of the more powerful in Europe. And in the context of the times, it was a rather tolerant and democratic state, also influential culturally. Lithuania's capital, Vilnius, is on a par with the great European cities in the fields of architecture, poetry, and science. One should also mention that Lithuanians have preserved a language that is rich and beautiful, and one into which the Bible, the entire Bible, was excellently translated already in the 16th century. For me, as a poet writing in Lithuanian, that has been especially rewarding. Lithuania revolted against the Tsarist government 3 times. Then it organized and maintained an unusually extensive and efficient web of samizdat and tamizdat, although the terms came into existence only many years later. This web of samizdat and tamizdat was instrumental in preparing the Lithuanians for independence in the future. After World War II, Lithuanians were not granted the 4 freedoms that Roosevelt had promised, namely freedom of speech, freedom of religion, freedom from want, freedom from fear. I would say that the lack of the freedom from fear was felt most keenly by everybody. However, my people kept fighting against Stalinism and played a crucial role in the disintegration of the Soviet totalitarian regime. The crimes committed by the Stalinists and later by the post-Stalinist authorities against the Lithuanians were hushed up, as well as Holocaust. And I can understand the wish of many people to commemorate those who died fighting against Stalin and against his girls. And I also understand, to a large degree, the aspirations of the Lithuanian nationalists. They demand for an equality of their own people with other nations, and for a proper and fitting place for the Lithuanians on the world stage are quite legitimate. But to me, the complex of a small nation that considers itself always right and in all circumstances a victim is unacceptable. Many people think that the whole truth about the history of a nation may deprive it of self-respect, weaken and harm it. Perhaps the same complex is not unfamiliar to the Jewish people, but I am not in a position to speak about that. Luckily, the Jewish people have many intellectuals who were critical of their own mentality, of their government, of Israel's policies, and so on. Unfortunately, we in Lithuania have only a few such intellectuals. So now, the least appealing pages of Lithuanian history coincide with the time of my childhood. I remember it to some degree, although I was 3 to 6 years old during the World War II. A violent outburst of anti-Semitism, which broke loose in Lithuania, in my opinion, went against the country's historical tradition. I tried to make sense of what was exactly that happened then. So now, to tell a bit more about it, First of all, when Stalin invited invaded Lithuania in 1940, well, there was a large number of repressions and deportations in in the usual Soviet manner. All the people in Lithuania, notwithstanding their background, suffered more or less equally. Not only ethnic Lithuanians, but the Poles were crammed into the cattle wagons. There were many Jews as well, even up to 20% perhaps, although it seems to be somewhat inappropriate in this case to be calculating percentages. But the Jewish bourgeoisie was, after all, more numerous than the Lithuanian bourgeoisie. So the deportation would probably have continued, because they resumed after the war, had not the German army invaded Lithuania and the Soviet Union. Then many people welcomed the invaders, and the Lithuanian armed detachments tried to cooperate with them. There were guerrilla forces that had taken control of a radio station in Kaunas even prior to the Germans' arrival, declaring the restoration of Lithuanian independence. These events came to be known in Lithuania as the June Uprising. Well, in my opinion, taking arms against the Stalinist regime was a legitimate deed. But almost immediately it went terribly wrong. It went terribly wrong because the uprising was being prepared and to some degree controlled by the young activists of pro-Nazi persuasion. In 1940, many of them traveled to Berlin and established connections with the Nazi authorities. Their objectives did not quite coincide with those of the Germans. Hitler did not envisage the coming into being of a Lithuanian state. And they were going to found a new independent Lithuania that would fight on the side of the Nazis, like Slovakia, like Croatia, like Finland, like Hungary. But at the same time, those young Lithuanian activists who based themselves in Berlin, they were planning to carry out a major ethnic and racial purge in this Lithuania to be, directed above all at the Jews, but also, by the way, against the Polish minorities. They were willing to sacrifice Lithuanian Jews to the Nazis. All that being in the name of independence. It did not strike any one of them that an independence so dearly bought loses all of its value, being an immoral game through and through. If a nation were to be saved by such means, it would as a consequence lose those very properties that justify an attempt at salvation in the first place. So the leaders of the uprising called themselves the Activist Front. They set up a provisional government in Lithuania, which lasted for 6 weeks. Now, and terrible pogroms took place from the very beginning, in June of 1941 and later. Hitler's government dispersed those Lithuanian activists, although for the most part they were never arrested and never repressed. But many of those guerrilla forces joined the German troops in extermination of Jewish people. So that was, as I have said, now I go back to the to my generation. That was rushed up during the Soviet period. The Soviets spoke about the victims of the Nazis, almost never mentioned, mentioning that, that these were Jews, but also accused the bourgeois nationalists, that is this activist front and provisional government, which perversely was taken by patriotic Lithuanians as a terrible Soviet lie, as terrible Soviet propaganda, and those people, if they can be called people, were considered to be national heroes. Well, it is painful to admit it, but even the most horrible organizations and the most horrible forces, including the KGB, sometimes also tell the truth, partially. Not all among those attacked by the Soviets were genuine heroes and freedom fighters. Within families, of course, the children heard things, but those overheard things were probably insufficient. There was everyday domestic anti-Semitism in the stories told by grandparents and parents, the desire to push out of mind memories, burdening the conscious, and so on. An apologetic approach to 1941 dominated in the common Lithuanian opinion, although it was never told openly, with certain small exceptions. It also dominated in the emigre community, which was broadcast back to Lithuania, and Jews were considered strangers par excellence. Now, well, during those 44 years after I wrote this article, telling the things I just told you, for probably for the first time in Soviet Lithuania, but that was an underground essay. Now, the things have changed to some degree. We have rather detailed information on Jewish topics in general Lithuanian history studies. There are also a large number of rather fundamental books on the legacy and past of Lithuanian Jews. And the great stratum of Litvak culture is no longer totally alien for ethnic Lithuanians. If it has not been integrated into Lithuanian culture, I believe the foundation for doing so has already been laid. There are many exhibits, for example, which touch upon Jewish Vilnius. And by no means are these exhibits exclusively by Jewish artists. It appears there is real and sincere interest in this, although it is often still seen as some sort of exotic enclave. For me, it's sad that there was not enough funding, or more likely it was lack of sufficient will, to buy Marc Chagall's painting of the Vilnius Synagogue for the Lithuanian Museum, although that was possible. The Vilna Gaon has become as inalienable part of the multi-ethnic heritage of Vilnius as the great Grand Duke Gediminas, founder of the city, or Adam Mickiewicz, or Czesław Miłosz, for that matter. The Jerusalem of the North concept has become part of the image of Vilnius, the capital of Lithuania. The late Itzhokas Meras and the living Grigorius Kanovičius have been recognized as creators of Lithuanian culture. And there are a number of usually successful films and plays centered on the topic of the past and the fate of the Jews. Many martyrological memoirs have been published, and the status of the Jews during the Nazi occupation is no longer hushed up. The attempt is being made to at least make it a part of public memory. Neither are the actions of Lithuanian collaborators being kept quiet, although these are only discussed at a very abstract level. Any accusation leveled at a specific person is still usually labeled slander and the KGB invention. The Vilna Ghetto is being restored. There are memorial plaques and statues there. Of course, it would be good, and I hold out hope that it will happen sooner or later, for the great synagogue to be rebuilt. In my article of 44 years ago, I wrote that the ghetto sections were being restored in such a way so that no one would remember they were Jewish. And that is our national shame. And now this is no longer true. Thank God it's no longer true. I would also like to say that a larger and good Jewish museum, such as the kind in Berlin and Warsaw, would be really needed in Vilnius. And I have hope this will happen. In my article, I wrote that Jews and Lithuanians for many, many long decades interacted as did the Martians and Earthlings, arrivals from Earth on Mars, in a story by Ray Bradbury. They lived in different spaces. Mm-hmm. And when they did meet, it was the consequence of a rare and lucky coincidence. Mm-hmm. This is probably no longer true. Lithuanians and Jews are no longer separate worlds who never cross paths. There are people in Lithuania, especially Irena Veisaitė, or late Leonidas Donskis, who were quite active in the Lithuanian community as well, and really were building very important bridges between two communities. There is some interest in Judaism. It's the theological, philosophical, and philological tradition. The tradition of argumentation, questioning, differing interpretations, the Judaic respect for knowledge. All of this has even become fashionable in certain Lithuanian circles. Lithuanian novels have appeared which attempt to deal fairly with Lithuanian role in and in Lithuanian relationship to the Holocaust. For example, a novel by Parulskis. Some other novels, which are unfortunately of not necessarily of a very high artistic level, but still such novels exist, and they are honest for the most part. Catholic priests have stepped forward, whose views on the Holocaust are beyond any reproach. For example, Julius Sasnauskas. All this is, however, more of an elite affair, and in general, amnesia holds court regarding not just the Jewish but also the Lithuanian past. And books no longer mean much, because our number of serious readers has narrowed considerably. In my old essay, I wrote that we have lived together for 600 years, and that perhaps that time is drawing to a close. And at such a moment, we cannot be enemies or unconcerned with one another. Happily, that period of living together has not totally drawn to a close. Because, as I have said, in Lithuania, there are still living people who are exerting a significant influence. On the other hand, there are still people who express their loyalty to the Judaic tradition. And it is a good thing there are such people. In the, my essay I wrote that we must understand the destruction of the Jews as our own destruction, the dehumanization of the Jews as our own dehumanization, and the liquidation of Jewish culture as an attempt on the life of our own Lithuanian culture. Has this become an axiom which the majority of Lithuanians accept without reservations? Unfortunately, I don't think so. Not only has anti-Semitism not disappeared, and its absolute disappearance apparently is an impossibility, since it seems to contain something metaphysical in its nature. Anti-Semitism has not become fringe. It rather frequently erupts forth in central public spaces, especially in the internet. Sociological studies show, of course, that the function of scapegoat, the tradition of the least liked group, has been assumed from the Jews by the Roma, or Gypsies, by the Muslims, by blacks, by homosexuals, and people with mental disabilities. But it is truly very cold comfort, because latent hatred of the other still exists in Lithuania. And it appears to be on gathering strength in moments of crisis. people often get the impression that Lithuanian-Jewish relations up till 1940 or 1941 were ideal. This was not the case. Perhaps they were somewhat better than in some neighboring countries. It were probably better than in Poland or Ukraine. But they were still marked by estrangement and alienation. Rather strong anti-Semitic tendencies, although not as strong as, say, for example, in Poland, have defined the public discourse in pre-war years in Lithuania. This bad tradition is also being studied carefully and objectively now, and it's a good thing it is being studied. But the Lithuanian discourse, as it concerns itself with the Holocaust, it still has gaps, to put it mildly. Well, because ethnic nationalism remains the entrenched paradigm of state ideology, this is unsurprising. Almost all figures in the Lithuanian 19th century movement created this paradigm, including all those for whom streets and squares are named and for whom statues are erected. For example, the historian Simonas Daukantas, nationalist leader Jonas Basanavičius, and President Smetona. Not all of them were anti-Semites, no. But some of them were. The still popular history written by Shapoka was based on this paradigm. Post-war partisans and almost all emigres adhered to it. During Soviet times, ethnic nationalism was of a dual nature. It was in no way alien to many communists and ideologues of their official persuasion, people such as the famous writer Justinas Marcinkevičius. On the other hand, ethnic nationalism was quietly propagated in almost every family. People conformed and collaborated with the Soviets, but in the depths of their soul, they were, as they believed themselves, real Lithuanians. And Justinas Marcinkevičius became a cult figure because he was just like them. The Lithuanian independence movement, Sąjūdis, followed the same paradigm of nationalism, although for practical reasons they sought not to emphasize it. According to this paradigm, the ethnic Lithuanian, excluding certain traitors, who should not properly be called Lithuanians, who were pro-Soviet, like Petras Cvirka. Now there is a movement requesting to remove his monument. Although Petras Cvirka was a really talented writer. By the way, when I met the best emigre poet, Alfonsas Nyka Niliūnas, in Washington, D.C., who was strictly anti-Soviet in his views, he asked me, who in your opinion is the best fiction writer in Lithuanian language? Well, I did not know what to answer. Then Nyka Niliūnas told, of course, Petras Cvirka. He is the very best. But he was pro-Soviet. For that reason, he is called a terrible traitor. And although he never promoted any killings or deportations or anything like that. And his monument, which is in its place in Vilnius, and I would say not quite bad artistically, it was done by a famous sculptor, Juozas Mikėnas. Now there are many voices that it must be removed, the sooner the better. Although there are other voices as well, including my own voice. I am not in a position to defend Petras Cvirka, because there is some conflict of interest. He was my distant relative. Yes. But, I also wrote an essay that defending Petras Cvirka, although I mentioned the fact that I am a bit uncomfortable doing it because of my family situation. So now, according to this ethnic nationalist paradigm, ethnic Lithuanian may be only either an innocent victim or a heroic fighter, and most often both at the same time. The Lithuanian always has been and always will be surrounded by terrible enemies, whose passionate desire, the only desire of any Russian, of any Pole, of any German, by the way, is to desecrate and destroy Lithuanian ethnic identity. And usually this or that individual Lithuanian as well. All acts by ethnic Lithuanians are justified because they are necessary self-defense and cannot be anything else. So the multicultural perspective and multicultural policies arrived in Lithuania from outside after entering the European Union. They had virtually no local roots. For that reason, many say with joy that policy has bankrupted Europe, although the sort of talk is clearly an exaggeration. Multiculturalism has entered into academia, but has not entered into the masses, nor into the majority of those in power who represent the thinking of the masses. Globalization, taken generally, is considered evil and even a treacherous conspiracy against ethnic identity. So this Lithuanian ideology is not too distant, for example, from the ideology of Marine Le Pen in France, or of Jaroslav Kaczynski in Poland, or Viktor Orban in Hungary. Almost all strong political forces in Lithuania support it. There is a silent agreement among them, a consensus. So officially, it is agreed that the Holocaust is a great evil. A special day is allocated for remembering the Holocaust. But at the same time, there is or was the official attempt to justify and even canonize people who were complicit in the Holocaust. Commemorations and memorial plaques were also dedicated to them. So this should properly be called a form of national and state schizophrenia. And this is what causes justified consternation and anger among Jews and more enlightened Lithuanians. So that does not contribute to Lithuania's standing in the world. It just detracts from it. And none of this, as is often claimed, present in inverted commas, a different Jewish and Lithuanian narrative, the end of the quotation, a contradiction between two ethnic views. No, this is a conflict between an honest and a dishonest view. This is not a crossroads where Jews and Lithuanians part ways. It is a crossroads in the heart of Lithuanian society. So I'm arriving to the end of my presentation, and I ended it 4 years ago in Vilnius, as Cato, the Roman senator, used to end his orations with a sentence: "Delenda est Carthago," or yes, Carthage must be destroyed. And I ended with two Carthages which should be destroyed. The first was the cult of the 1941 year uprising and the provisional government. I wrote about this 44 years ago, and since that time, having gained more information, my opinion of the provisional government of Škirpen and Brezavičius has only declined. Antisemitism was part of their program. There is no reason and no possibility to hide it. And the tragic consequences of that absolutely annul anything this government supposedly achieved. It is said that they successfully recreated the Lithuanian administration, but that was primarily the creation of the police and civil services, which were only too easily employed by the Nazis. If we call the events of June of 1941 the beginning of Honor of Resistance, as we do as Landsbergis, by the way, usually does, we place a large black blemish on all of it, including the justified post-war Lithuanian anti-Soviet resistance. These events should not be given honor in the textbooks. It must be said clearly that from the very start, the orientation to Hitler's Germany was a great error and was totally unacceptable. And that at best, the Lithuanian insurgents were naive, at worst there were many criminals among them. Ambrazevičius, the head of the provisional government, was reburied with state funds and with a honor guard. That was a huge moral error. Well, I was asked, by the way, well, now I can confess, the former Lithuanian president, Dalia Grybauskaitė, asked me, well, when we met for a very short time, 15 minutes or something like that, do you have any advice for me as a president? I said, if Ambrazevičius is being reversed in Kaunas, which was prepared at that time, well, we are a democratic country and people who like Ambrazevičius can do it. But the state should not tell one word about it and to pay 1 cent for it, yes, for that rebellion. They did not tell a word about it, but they presented a honor guard and they paid for the rebellion. They paid the expenses of transferring his remains from the United States. So, in my opinion, that was a huge moral error. Fortunately, it was condemned by a considerable number of Lithuanian intellectuals, including the national hero Tomas Šernas. One hysterical politician called those people who protested against this honorable rebellion. That was something like, yes, in France that would be similar to the honorable rebellion of Petain, Marshal Petain. Absolutely the same situation. One hysterical politician called those people, including my humble person, Quislings. Although, of course, the typical Quisling was none other than Ambrazevičius, since he publicly proposed Lithuanian's alliance with Hitler. So the attempt is or was being made officially to sit on two different chairs at once. Škirpa and Ambrazevičius perhaps made some slight mistakes, but essentially they worked for the good of the country and therefore deserve respect. Well, there is a very uncomfortable but apt parallel, the official position of today's Putin's Russia regarding Stalin. He perhaps destroyed more people than necessary, but he worked for the good of the country, and therefore he deserves the respect of Russians. Such argument would be unacceptable for any Lithuanian, but argument for Škirpa Ambrazevičius is of absolutely the same logical kind. So, in my opinion, that demonstrates the pathetic state of thinking in our society. And the second Carthago, the theory of the so-called double or symmetric genocide. For example, the museum in Vilnius dedicated to the Lithuanian anti-Soviet resistance was called the Museum of the Genocide. So in my opinion, that was not genocide, that was stratocide. The Lithuanian elite was destroyed, but not Lithuanians as such. There were thousands and at the very end, dozens of thousands of pro-Soviet Lithuanians who did not suffer and who were generally, as a rule, beyond any danger. Which was, of course, not the case of Jews during the Hitler period. So, I proposed to name that museum the Museum of the Crimes of Communism. And recently it has been changed. The name has been changed. Now it is called the Museum of the Occupations and fight for freedom, which is more appropriate, definitely more appropriate. The Jewish genocide, yes, the Jewish genocide, the Holocaust is, has another museum, which is small and to some degree neglected, but it does exist in Vilnius. It does exist. So something changes. Recently, there happened something very important. The mayor of Vilnius changed the name of the street in the very middle of the city. Curiously enough, there is no houses on that street. Yes, it is an alley going next to the Hill of Gediminas, but it is the very, very middle of the city, the East historical center. It was called the Alley of Škirpa. This person who wanted to be a head of pro-Nazi Lithuanian government, but the real head became Ambrozevičius, who does not have a street in Vilnius. But Škirpa had. So this name was removed. This name was removed. And that was a sort of a new development, very new and very unusual development. Of course, it created a stir. Some people demonstrated for Škirpa, but I strongly hope that the demonstrations were marginal. A demonstration is called tomorrow, just before the presidential palace. Let's see how many people will come. I strongly hope they will. The number of the people who will come will be negligible. If not, we should be worried about that, really worried. But generally, it's the Škirpa's name is defended only by the political bankrupts. There are several of these. Recently, one of them put his candidacy for Lithuania as president during the presidential elections and got 4%, yes, 4% of votes. Another one who now is convening this demonstration on the 5th of September, another one proposed his candidacy for the European Parliament, and he got 3% of the votes. So hopefully they are marginal, hopefully. So, and general attitude of the Lithuanian government, of the new president Nausėda, and of Vilnius mayor, yes, Vilnius mayor Šimašius, also newly elected mayor, is adequate. At present, it is adequate. If they capitulate, I hope it will never happen, that would be a cause for a serious worry. So, sorry for this a bit chaotic presentation. I would try to answer your questions.
Labai ačiū Jums, profesor Venslova. If I may just ask, just to open up the discussion, I hope to facilitate further questions.
May I ask you, Jakob? Was it intelligible?
May I not answer?
No worries.
It was fascinating. Thank you so much.
Okay.
And my question is, to what extent do you think this problem that you discussed is generational? And the second part of the same question is, perhaps, tomorrow you speak at YIVO, and in 2015, I happened to be present at the first YIVO conference in Vilnius since 1938, which was held, among other places, at the Parliament on a Sunday, but that's another question. So what else, the second part of my question goes, should be, in your opinion, should be the state, the government, including the government of the city of Vilnius, what else should it do on multiple different levels that take up the authority to bring together the two different generational origins of that issue, perhaps, if that makes sense.
Well, to answer your first and probably the main question, to which degree it is generational? Yes, it is. It definitely is. I think the younger generation is much freer in this respect. Those marginal people who demonstrate for Škirpa, there is another situation which is even more complicated. Which is even more complicated of Noreika, I will tell more about that. But those marginal people who demonstrate for the sake of those, Holocaust perpetrators, to tell the truth, they are, as a rule, old people. They are, as a rule, old, to put it mildly, not very enlightened, old people. And the demonstration which took place in Vilnius a month ago, I looked at the TV screen, and being not in Lithuania, but in Balkans, and my estimate was that there were around 200 persons. For a rather big city which Vilnius is, it's almost a negligible quantity. But we'll see. So it is generational. Young people are almost never present there. Except, several persons. There is a group which calls itself Propatria. They have an internet site. They publish, in my opinion, terrible things, but I don't think they are very popular. I don't think they are very popular. And the result of this vote, of this recent vote, shows for sure that they are supported only by some part of the old generation. Only by some part. And I probably did not catch your second question. Could you put it very shortly?
Given the support of the study of Lithuanian Jewry that the government already offers, I mentioned this conference of YIVO in Vilnius in 2015 for the first time. So YIVO, so to speak, came back to Vilnius in 1938. What else is there the government should do, in your opinion, to eradicate this problem, perhaps, or reconcile it in the two generations?
As I have told already, I put it into my presentation that I think that, for example, the Great Synagogue in Vilnius should be rebuilt. They did rebuild the Grand Duke's Palace in Vilnius. I was against it because it is, simulacrum, it's something unauthentic. But here I may remember what Hemingway said once. He was shown Carcassonne. Carcassonne is a fortified city in southern France, incredibly, incredibly impressive. And Hemingway said, oh my goodness. Then he was told, but that is a fake building by Viollet le Duc of the 19th century. At that Hemingway answered, so what? So, when I saw the Grand Duke's Palace in Vilnius, which is absolutely unauthentic, I also, Hemingway said, it's unauthentic, so what? It is a very good place for exhibitions, for example. We can really do perfect exhibitions of European art. We never had such space in Vilnius before. For example, there was an exhibition of Florentian art, art of Firenze, including Fra Angelico and such names, which never came to Vilnius before. And they were totally in place in that building. So now I consider that I was wrong. It was good that the palace was rebuilt. The same with synagogue. And it is easier to do it with the Great Synagogue of Vilnius because very many documents very big documentation survives, which was not the case of the Grand Duke's Palace. It could be done. It could be done, and I think it would be good. What more? There was a special conference considering the fate of the Great Synagogue. After the war, the walls of the Great Synagogue still stood, only the walls. It was, of course, desecrated and destroyed by the Nazis, but it could be rebuilt. The Soviets destroyed even the walls. So both regimes contributed to it. But it could be, now, yes, in that conference with some specialists from Israel, also from other countries, and also some Lithuanian specialists, they say that it should be the place of memory, but just the place of memory, not the walls, not the building as such. I spoke at that conference, and I said that I would prefer to have a great synagogue yes, as it is. Perhaps it would be an empty shell, because I doubt it would have a minyan all the time. unfortunately, it is as simple as that. Although, well, there is a new synagogue which was not destroyed during the war, and we, with my friend Pranas Morkus, we attended its anniversary celebration. It was full of, not full, but there were probably several dozens of Jewish people inside, and two ethnic Lithuanians and Goys and previous Christians, Pranas Morkus and myself. Only we two Goys had headwear. So you see, the situation of Judaism in Lithuania is not very good, to tell the truth. But it could exist as a sort of museum. And I think that Vilnius should have a good Jewish museum like Warsaw has. And government could and should support it. So I proposed it. And as far as I know, it is being considered. Also discussed with the Israel embassy and so on and so on. But it is being considered. Now, of course, the material about the Jewish history in Lithuania should be included in the textbooks. To some degree, it is included. I risk being immodest, but I just wrote a history of Lithuania for the common people, so to speak. It is comprised of two volumes. The first volume has already appeared, and there are several chapters about the Jewish history in Lithuania, as honest and as objective as I am able to do it. The second volume will appear in October, and I expect a big discussion of it, because it's about Škirpa and Abrazevičius, I say everything I think and what I just said. I say that in the second volume. And also, risking of being immodest, I can tell you that the first volume was successful. It even brought me some income, which is a rarity in Lithuania. Yes, please.
Okay, do we need
this
microphone?
Do you want
a mic? Please. Oh.
I actually was going to ask you about the textbooks in Lithuania, but did you read Tim Snyder's book, Black Earth, which addresses, there's a chapter that addresses the collaboration between the Nazis and the Lithuanian...
Well, I think the Black Earth was not yet translated into Lithuanian, but the Bloodlands have been translated. And... There is an error, a historical error in Timothy Snyder's book. I don't remember was it corrected or not. He says that Škirpa was present in Lithuania during the uprising. He was not. he was not. But generally, he says all things about the Lithuanian collaboration already in the Bloodlands. And that has been translated. Also, yes, risking to be very modest. The book has a motto of my own poem.
Oh, okay.
But in Lithuanian translation, the motto is absent.
Oh. But I did want to ask you, is there an effort now in Lithuania to preserve the current community of the Jewish community to preserve materials and put them in the Jewish Museum there?
Yes, there is some effort. There is some effort. And Timothy Snyder is a popular person in Lithuania. He's a popular person, and his Bloodlands is widely read book. Well, there was the story about Ruta Vanagaitė, which was mentioned, I think, by Jakob Klotz, Professor Jakob Klotz, and, well, that was a very unpleasant story. Ruta Vanagaitė wrote a book, Musiške, which can be translated as Our People. This is a book, a bit a commercial book. A bit a commercial book, but a good book. I wrote a blurb for it, and I praised it. It appealed with that blurb, yes, among other blurbs. And she speaks that, her main idea is very profound, that the Jewish people, the Jewish victims were our people, but the perpetrators were also our people. We must confront both of those problems. And the book had success. It was a bestseller. Later, Ruta Vanagaitė created a scandal, and she accused one of the Lithuanian guerrilla leaders after the war, saying that he took some part in the Holocaust, which was not proved. And I hope it is untrue. So, but that then, all the anti-Semites who were unhappy with her book, but did not tell it when the book appeared, or said it in a very roundabout way, now they attacked Vanagaitė. She was literally hounded. In the best Soviet tradition. In the best Soviet tradition, I would Vytautas Landsbergis, whom I respect to a degree, Vytautas Landsbergis called her Dušanskienė. Well, Dušanskis was a member of the CK, of the KGB, of Jewish origin, who is considered a great Soviet criminal. He died in Israel. Several years ago, so he called her the wife of Dušanskis, which is a strictly anti-Semitic word, of course. I wrote an essay about, not an essay, but an answer to Landsbergis. I said that together with Dušanskis, there were Liaudis, who was minister of KGB. There was Bartavičius, who was the head of the group which investigated this case. There was a person, an ethnic Lithuanian, who was a traitor, who put this partisan under the Soviet trial. All they were ethnic Lithuanians. So why Dušanskienė? Why not Liaudienė? Why not Martavičienė? Why not Urbonienė? Even such names, such names would be inappropriate, of course. But Dušanskienė is totally inappropriate and testifies only to the very strong latent anti-Semitism in many of Lithuanian circles. I wrote it, it was published. I got my own portion of curses in the internet and so on, but much less than Ruta Vanagaitė. So perhaps I strongly hope that in case of that partisan leader, of that guerrilla leader, she was wrong. But her hounding was totally, totally unacceptable, totally inappropriate, and hier steig kan ik anders, as Martin Luther said. Okay, what else?
What name did they use of the street where they took the name of Weskip? What was the replacement name?
Ah, the place name is the name Trispalvius Street. That means the street of the tricolor. Tricolor is a Lithuanian flag.
Ah, right.
Tricolor is a Lithuanian flag.
It's still patriotic.
Yes.
It's still patriotic.
It's still patriotic, but I don't see anything really wrong in that. Well, it's a long story. I could say something about it, but it's a very long story. And because in his young years, Škirpa, before he became a Nazi, he was the person who placed the Lithuanian tricolor on the Gediminas Tower. And in a sense, so to speak, latently, it is also praising Škirpa without mentioning his name. But Škirpa was ordered to do it by Ludas Gira. Ludas Gira was the war commandant of Vilnius at that time, and he ordered Škirpa place that Lithuanian tricolor. And Ludas Gira became a pro-Soviet figure who is as cursed as Petras Cvirka, if not more. So it's a very, very complicated story. Okay.
Thank you very much. I found it very interesting. My question is a little bit outside of your talk.
Yes.
When you were talking about the Lithuanian nationalists who saw things only white or black, themselves white, and the whoever was against them was black. Well, I'm a pragmatist. I think reality is too complex to see it in black and white. That we must learn to see it in tones of gray.
But
like I think Vonnegut is doing it somewhat. If I may bring in something, reality is also so complex. There's a philosopher of science, Richard Gere, from the University of Minnesota. He says that you cannot look at reality because of its complexity in terms of this is absolute truth and this is not. You have to look at it in terms of perspectives. My perspectives is based on so much data, so much evidence, and so much analysis, and it can change all the time. As science, scientific knowledge, for example, is changing all the time.
Okay.
And I think
I understand.
Our thinking comes from religion. Very much, because in religion, of course, many religions it's black and white, good and God and devil, good and evil, and so on. And in the real world, it really doesn't work.
Sometimes
we should learn how to think.
Sometimes it works. There are 50 shades of gray, of course, and probably more than 50. There are definitely. But for example, Škirpa, there is a letter of Škirpa written to President Smetona, who was an emigre at that time. And Škirpa says, Mr. President, you should agree that a Lithuanian party of Hitler's followers should be arranged, should be established. It could be called activists, but we must take the National Socialist program, the National Socialist paradigm. If you don't agree, well, that's bad. So Smetona, thank God, never agreed, and he was a very, very bad opinion about Mr. Škirpa. So in my opinion, this is simply black. This is not gray. Then there were persons who saved Jews, and some of them perished. For example, there is a famous stage director of Lithuanian Jewish origin, but he is as Lithuanian as myself. He speaks perfect Lithuanian. He does not speak, I think, either Jewish or Hebrew. His name is Kama Ginkas. Now he is active in Moscow as a Russian stage director. Well, but we are good friends. So Kamagintas was saved. He was 3 to 4 years old. He was brought out of the ghetto, and the Lithuanian, well, how they call it in the nurse, a Lithuanian medical nurse, Lithuanian medical nurse saved him and brought him up as her own son. And much later he met her and asked, well, were you afraid or not? She said, well, yes, of course I was afraid, because I could be shot. But in this case, I would know for that I was shot for something, for something. So this is white. The Škirpa is black, this is white. And, yes. And in between there are, of course, 50 Shades of Grey. Of course there are.
Hello, I'm here, in the back.
Yes?
I don't know if you can see me.
Let me come closer. Well, my problem is not so much speaking as understanding spoken English. I understand written English very well. I can read voice and spoken without any problems.
Okay, so I will use the mic so everybody else can hear.
But for example, when I watch American movies, as a rule, I don't understand anything at the time.
Thank you so much for your talk. It's very interesting. I think my question is complex, and I don't really know how to put it. I think when I was reading The City of Strangers by Laimonas Briedis, I don't know if you read that book. I think this was the first time when I read the more negative connotation towards Lithuanians being patriotic. Mm-hmm. And I'm a younger generation, I grew up in Lithuania where Lithuanians are heroes who fought for independence, and now you talk about the negative side as well today.
Yes.
And of course it's not black and white, so I think I don't know if it's a question, it's more maybe a question for myself. I think I'm trying to find a way how to live with this multi-dimensional identity,
yes,
of negative and positive.
Yes.
So I guess my question to you is also how to find a place in being a Lithuanian, more like being patriotic, so it's also a positive connotation, but also that it has a negative side. Talking about the Holocaust.
You know, about how to be a Lithuanian patriot or a Lithuanian nationalist. Once I was attacked in the press and I was and they talked, well, Venslova is not a Lithuanian, he's a cosmopolitan.
Mm-hmm.
This is a very common accusation. Well, to that I answered, a cosmopolitan is a vice nationalist. Yes. A chauvinist is a stupid nationalist. As simple as that. Now, well, yes, Briedis's book is very good, very interesting, definitely very interesting. And I like the book, and I like Mr. Briedis, Professor Briedis himself. So, well, I also wrote something similar. I wrote a book under the title Vilnius's Names, the Names of Vilnius. Around 600 of people connected with Vilnius. All kinds of people, including Napoleon, but also because he was present in Vilnius for some time, and including also such not very pleasant personalities as Goebbels, who also was in Vilnius for some time and visited Vilnius ghetto, and including Felix Dzerzhinsky, who was brought up in Vilnius, including Lenin, who visited Vilnius. But this is also a long and interesting story, because, well, I will tell the story because it's interesting enough. It was known that Lenin spent one night in Vilnius, being a very young revolutionary, before the establishment of the Bolshevik Party. But he came to Vilnius, and one of my friends, who was a filmmaker, decided to find out where Lenin lived, in which house he stayed. and he found it. He was pretty sure that he will get the Lenin Prize for that or something. For yes, at least when you deploy it. But that was hushed up, and he was strongly reprimanded because Lenin spent the night in a house of one member of Bund, yes, of the Jewish Socialist Party, which of course the Soviet leader could not have anything in common with Bund. So this is, but I write about that in Pilner's Names and tell the entire story. So, but this Vilnius names, they show Vilnius as a very multicultural city, very. There are many Lithuanians, mainly in the very beginning and mainly in the very end. And in between there are hundreds of Poles, hundreds of Jews, dozens of Russians, dozens of Belarusians, and literally hundreds of Italians, for example, because almost all the artists in Vilnius invited by the Lithuanian Grand Dukes were of Italian origin. So there was a strong Italian community in Vilnius. And we cannot be good Lithuanian patriots if we are not cosmopolitan in that sense, that those Italians and those Jews and those Poles and those Belarusians and those Russians, well, except really odious figures like Goebbels or Dzerzhinsky, all are part of Vilnius, all are part of Lithuanian tradition, of our ethnic Lithuanian tradition. We have two big cities, three big cities, Vilnius, Kaunas and Klaipėda. Vilnius is multinational, Kaunas is more or less strictly Lithuanian, although also not necessarily so, because the philosopher Levinas, who was Jewish, came from Kaunas. Painter Dobužinsky, who was Russian, was active in Kaunas, and so on and so on. Shalapin sang on the Kaunas scene, although he was ex-Russian, so to speak. So, but Kaunas is much more nationalist, and I would say narrowly nationalist. At the time, city is Klaipėda, which was German. Which was a German-speaking city. There were some Lithuanian figures, ethnic Lithuanians, but much more German-speaking figures. They are all also our people. They are also our people. So it's very complicated. Also with lots of shades of gray, of course. Lots of shades of gray here.
Thank you. We have one more question from this corner.
Only one?
Thank you, Professor. You spoke about the ethical aspect. My question is about art. Could I ask you about the influence of Lithuanian Jewish culture on Lithuanian poetry and your own work in particular?
Well, you see, that was that those things were very, very different. They did not mix. During the interwar period, there were some Jewish painters, for example, who entered the Lithuanian milieu and were active in Lithuanian art, like Arvid Blatas, for example, and several others. Only now, only at present, well, in the Soviet period as well. In the Soviet period, you had Icchok Asmeras, who was a child saved by ethnic Lithuanians from the ghetto, brought up by Lithuanians, just like Kamalinkas. So Icchok Asmeras wrote in Lithuanian, mainly on Jewish topics. And well, he's a part of Lithuanian culture, of course, and I would say an influential part. And Kanovičius, or Kanovič, who is a special case because he speaks good Lithuanian, but he does not write in Lithuanian. He writes in Russian, and he lives in Israel, but does not write in Hebrew, or even Yiddish. He writes in Russian on Jewish-Lithuanian topics. And he's quite popular and quite liked in Lithuania. So now, at present, some interconnection of Lithuanian and Jewish artists is taking place. But this is a new phenomenon. Now, well, and to add, I did not end probably, did not finish the answer to the question. So can we be a patriots if we speak about the negative moments in Lithuanian history? I think that only then we can be a patriots. All other type of patriots are fake patriots. Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much, Acho. Thank you. Please come again to our other events.